Good afternoon. If you are anything like me, you tune out the economic stories in the news and yet are fascinated and entertained by Freakonomics. It is difficult for most of us to see the connection between the global economic forecasts we hear on the news and the economics of sumo wrestling we read about in Levitt and Dubner's best-selling book. But there is a fundamental idea that connects these stories: decision making. At its most basic level, economics is about modeling and understanding decision making. If one wants to understand the current problems in the housing market, then he or she needs to understand the decision making process of the consumers who may be purchasing a home, the sellers marketing the home, the banks who may or may not be providing the mortgage, and almost everyone else involved in the process. The beauty of Freakonomics is that Levitt and Dubner apply economic analyses to decision making in situations like sumo wrestling, where it is both novel and entertaining. Our next speaker, Paul Glimcher, also uses economic ideas and methods to understand decision making. But what makes his work unique is that he doesn't use these ideas to understand markets or communities or even individual consumers. He applies economic analysis to better understand the decision-making process within the brain at the neural level. This may not sound terribly surprising at first. After all, we do think before we make a decision, don't you? But I think you will learn in the next hour that the economic methods used by Paul and his colleagues provide unique insight into the workings of our brain. One common approach to understanding a neural network, whether it be in the brain or elsewhere, is to conduct experiments to elucidate the biophysical and connective properties of the network. And we've heard about some of that today and yesterday. Then we write down differential equations to model the network and use simulations and mathematics to understand the output. A fundamental difficulty in this approach is that it begins at the neural architecture and hopes to replicate the output. While this is a great approach to understanding rhythm-generating neural networks, for example, it has generally been inadequate to understand parts of the brain that process sensory input and generate motor output. And it is here that neuroeconomics comes to the fore. In the words of Professor Glimcher, economic theories like expected utility or behavioral game theory can be used to define the computational goal of the neural architecture for decision making. This then constrains what kind of measurement should be made by neurobiologists and provides a theoretical framework for organizing the huge amount of neurobiological data on choice already available. Professor Glimcher began studying neuroscience at Princeton, where he graduated with an AB in 1983. He then pursued his Ph.D. in neuroscience at the University of Pennsylvania, where he earned his Ph.D. in 1989. He teaches at New York University, where he is the Julius Silver Professor of Neuroscience, Economics, and Psychology, and directs the Center for Neuroeconomics. He is the author of many papers and several books, including Decisions, Uncertainty, and the Brain, The Science of Neuroeconomics. He is the founding president of the Society for Neuroeconomics and is the recipient of a variety of fellowships and awards for his research, writing, and teaching. So how does a neuroscientist come to embrace the utility of economics? Not very easily, it seems. When Paul first decided that he needed to learn real economics, he reached out to a colleague in the economics department at NYU to ask for advice and was told, "Paul, the very last thing anyone needs in this world is a neuroscientist who knows economics." My advice is, get back in the elevator, go downstairs, across the street to your building, and never come back here again. Thankfully, even this failed to discourage Paul. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Professor Paul Glimcher.
Perfect.
Well, first, let me say thank you. Thank you for the invitation. Thank you for the opportunity to participate. Thank you for this incredible conference that you guys hold. And of course, thank you to all the Gusties for making this possible. Now, yeah. So what I want to talk about today is decision-making, how it works in your head. I think it's instructive to think back to the last time the Nobel Conference focused on neuroscience. As I understand it, that was 1994, and ask, what was known about decision-making in the brain then? What would the neuroscience of decision have been in 1994? Excuse me. The answer is not much. What's happened over the course of the last 20 years, maybe even 15, is our understanding of human decision-making at the neurobiological level has been completely transformed. What I hope I'll show you in the next hour is that not only do we now understand a few of the basics, but the broad outline of the human mechanism for decision-making is now well understood. And we're in the process of beginning to seriously refine modern economic theory to make it more predictive and more efficient, and that's possible because of the breakthroughs we've made over the last 15 years. Now, to understand why we were stuck 15 years ago, I need to review with you for a moment what the sort of history of biologists thinking about decision-making was, what the history of economists thinking about decision-making was, and why it was difficult to reconcile those two ideas. Let me stress that when we talk about decision-making, there's a temptation to think I'm talking about abstract monetary decisions, or market-level decisions, or how banking houses operate. Of course, that's not what I'm talking about. What we really want to understand is how you choose a spouse, how you choose a dinner, how you choose to attend a different one talk or another at this meeting. And the goal of economics, I think, at the micro level, is really to understand how we do that, both at a neurobiological level and at a predictive computational level. But for physiologists, the history of thinking about that problem really begins with this man, René Descartes. Descartes, as many of you may know, thought of the process of human behavior as being composed of two sub-processes. One he thought of as very automatic. He used the French verb réfléchir to communicate the idea that stimuli from the outside environment bumped into the nervous system and were reflected out in a very predictable way. He said these things could be studied by neurobiologists. Of course, in those days, that would be physiologists. But there was a second class of behavior, voluntary behavior, the really interesting stuff, which he argued lay entirely outside the boundaries of study by neurobiologists. And so for that area, he partitioned away what physiologists and neuroscientists could think about, what we really probably all imagine is the most interesting part of decision making. Now, it's important to remember that Descartes didn't just say this, but he even provided a basic theoretical model for thinking about how we could connect events in the outside world with the actions we produce under simple conditions. This is from his 1664 book, Treatise on Man. I'm not going to read you the text underneath, but I do want to draw your attention to the basic idea. Descartes' idea was that this little flame down here emitted high-speed particles which bumped into this little guy's foot. Those high-speed particles pulled on little strings traveling up these tubes, which opened a pneumatic valve and allowed the life-giving pneuma to escape from the brain, back down this tube, activate this muscle, and cause the foot to move away from the fire. It's actually a pretty interesting idea. The core of his idea, though, you have to bear in mind, is this notion of reflection, the idea that it's stimulus, response, connection. And of course, that became the core of the way neurobiologists thought about this problem. It's tempting at this point to think that during the French Enlightenment and after that, when people were thinking about this problem this way, they imagined that these behaviors were really dumb. They were really simple, terrible, uninteresting behaviors. And that really wasn't true. This idea matured over the course of the next 200 years, and though people stuck with the idea of the reflex, they began to see it as a richer and richer process. The most famous work in this area was probably by the French mechanician Jacques de Vaucanson, the father of modern robotics. And Vaucanson was fascinated by building objects, like his famous quacking, flapping duck. The duck was a mechanical device that could actually interact with an audience, that could quack, it actually ate, it actually pooped. It was a pretty cool animal. And Vaucanson was trying to communicate the idea that this mechanism that had originally been proposed by Descartes was incredibly flexible. Here you see a famous automaton by a follower of Vaucanson's, Henri Milliardet. And the Milliardet automaton here at the Franklin Institute in Philadelphia is actually in the process of drawing a little picture of a sailboat. We'll see that in a second. What I want to communicate here is that these guys were committed to the notion of stimulus response. They were committed to the notion that we traced activity through the nervous system as a pathway that involved some kind of reflection. But they were open to the idea that these behaviors were pretty complicated. Now, the person who turned this into neurobiology was the English Nobel laureate Charles Scott Sherrington. In the early 1900s, Sherrington laid out what was really the Cartesian framework at a neurobiological level. He showed that these pathways conducting information from the fire were actually sensory neurons at known locations in the brain. He identified the motor neurons, which control the activations of muscles. And he built a theory of human behavior that, in his mind, could produce things as complicated as that little automata drawing a picture of a sailboat, using neurons in this sort of very sensory motor way. The critical idea I want you to come away with is that the neurobiological tradition, until about 20 years ago, was really focused on this notion that things happened in the outside world, and the job of the nervous system was to gate those neat things to the right muscles to produce complex behavior. That's a great idea. It's a very powerful idea. It's been used widely. But what's really striking, and I have to say what struck me most as a young neuroscientist, physiologist, psychologist, something like that, was how different, I'm never quite sure what I am. It depends which faculty meeting I'm at. Was its difference from the way economists think about these problems. If you ask an economist, how do I think about the problem of making a decision, they don't tell you some story about the stimulus in the outside world and the motor response they produce. Modern economic theory really has its roots in the work of the Nobel Prize-winning economist Paul Samuelson. And what Samuelson taught all of us in economics was that the right way to think about economic behavior was to, first of all, think about representations. If I know something about the way you make choices, do I know something about the way you must be representing the values of those choices? Now, Samuelson didn't think about this in the brain and was adamant that he wasn't talking about the brain, but he was talking about mathematical representations. Let me show you Samuelson's greatest theorem. I'll show it to you in cartoon form, and it'll really give you a sense for how economists think about these problems. So imagine Tom, who just introduced me, is asked a bunch of questions, and he reveals to me that he prefers apples to oranges, and oranges to pears. What's his opinion on apples versus pears? It was Samuelson's insight that as long as he prefers apples to pears, his three sets of choices are consistent. This stands in contrast to someone whose choices are inconsistent, who prefers apples to oranges, oranges to pears, but ironically prefers pears to apples. Now, Samuelson recognized how incredibly important this point was, and I want to show you why. This is a cartoon, this is actually a cartoon of one of my graduate students doing one of her experiments. So this is Stefano Lazzaro, and she comes to her experiment with an orange and an apple. I guess this, I'm sorry about this, this has now turned out to be Tom, so I apologize. And here are Tom's preferences, and here's Tom unaccountably wearing this dress. And Tom is standing there with this pear. And 3 cents in his purse, unfortunately. Okay, so Stephanie says, hey, I'll give you this orange for a pear. Tom says, well, I prefer oranges to pears. Stephanie says, well, you have to pay me a penny for that. And so Tom says, okay. And now Tom is in the position of having this orange, which he prefers to pears, but now he only has 2 cents. And he feels good about himself. Stephanie then reaches behind her and pulls out an apple and asks the same question. Would you like to trade your apple for an orange for 1 cent? Tom consults his internal preferences, says, yep, that looks like a good deal to me, and makes the trade. So here's where it gets interesting. Now Stephanie reaches behind her back and pulls out Tom's original pear. And she turns to him and says, hey, I happen to have this pear. I'll give you this pear for that apple plus 1 cent. Of course, what has happened now is Tom has traded back his, this little pointer guy, come on. Tom has traded back his original pair, and he's lost 3 cents. Stephanie, of course, can do this forever. And each time it happens, Tom feels incredibly happy, because he's got exactly what he wants, and now Stephanie has all his money. Okay. What's interesting about this is for a chooser who does not behave this way, this is what Samuelson proved, for a chooser who cannot be money pumped in this way, who has consistent and transitive preferences, it turns out that that is equivalent to saying that they have an internal representation of the value of things to them, that as you increase the number or quantity that you are offering them, you increase the value. In mathematical terms, we say it increases weakly, so it's allowed to plateau, but it's never allowed to come down. A chooser who behaves transitively has behavior that suggests such a representation. Now, these two guys, John von Neumann and Oscar Morgenstern, extended that idea, and they showed that if you show consistent behavior, not just with regard to the value of a good, but also with regard to the probability that you'll obtain it, this is essentially saying that if I have the probability that I'll give you the apple, you view that as having the value of the offer. So this critical notion that these guys communicated was that probability was important, and that we could build representational theories that rested on the notion of value and probability simultaneously. Okay, so how does an economist think about choice? An economist then imagines that if I offer Tom an apple, he's doing is picking some internal value that he associates with apples, multiplying it by the probability I'll actually give it to him. This is where I'm a sort of not trustworthy apple salesman. This leads to an average value for that apple. And when Tom's asked to choose amongst more than one thing, the idea here is that he's going to compare all of these final decision variables and see which one is highest. In this case, he picks the orange. He prefers apples to oranges, but the probability of getting the apple is lower than the probability of getting the orange, and they compensate for each other so that he picks this one. Now, what's neat about this description is it's very intuitive and human, but it lacks any neurobiological mechanism. There's no idea here of how the brain does this. And so, of course, the critical question that arose about a decade and a half ago was, could you bring these two traditions together? Could you ask where or how in the brain is the economic representation constructed, and could we develop evidence that it really guides human choice behavior? Now, I want to tell you about the first place we did that, and it was very much following in the traditional physiologist tradition. This is work I did with my old postdoc, Michael Platt, who's now the director of the Center for Cognitive Neuroscience at Duke University. Michael and I took a couple of shortcuts studying decision-making in monkeys. The first shortcut we took was that we presented all the options to the monkeys visually. The reason we did that is because we know so much about the human and monkey visual system. So there's no telling them a story. We're just going to show them basically apples and oranges and ask them to pick. And we're going to ask them to pick not by reaching with their arm, which as we learned this morning is an extremely complicated thing, but by moving their eyes. And the reason for that is we really understand the neural circuitry for eye movement control. So we're going to be looking at a circuit that's composed of a sensory component, like Descartes, this is the input part, an output component, like the part where the pneuma moves the muscles in the Cartesian model, but we're going to focus at the point of interaction between these two systems and ask not whether it is a source of reflection, but whether it is a source of economic representation. Now, before I show you that experiment, I have to tell you a tiny bit more about this area, which I labeled area LIP. Its real name is the lateral intraparietal area. Here, what I've done is I've flattened it out. I've sort of pulled that out of a monkey's head in cartoon and flattened it out for you. What I want to stress is that it's a sheet with a large number of cells. We'll take a look at a cartoon representation of it in more detail in a moment. And neurons at each location on this cartoon sheet care about a particular eye movement. So if you thought of the monkey as being told to press with his eye a button located here, the neuron that would be responsible for that would be located here. You can see that in the lower panel. Here I'm showing this cartoon monkey. In my lab, we call this the larval monkey. And I'm plotting for you here the firing rate of the neuron as a function of time. And you can see the neuron responds with a burst of activity when the monkey makes this movement. But if the monkey makes a larger movement, a shorter movement, an upward movement, or a downward movement, all of those lead to lesser activation, and that's because what this neuron really cares about is this particular movement. But of course, there are lots of neurons here, so all choices, all options, all actions are represented on this keyboard of possible movements. And what we're going to ask is whether or not this keyboard of possible movements does more than reflection. And the way Michael did that was he trained monkeys to essentially play roulette. We've been, some of the presenters have been talking about this, and it's probably bad. John told me never go to a casino, and I have exactly the opposite reaction, no doubt because I'm an economist. Okay, so I even bring casinos into my labs and force monkeys to play them. So here's the monkey casino game. Monkey fixates straight ahead. I'm recording from a neuron that I hypothesize tells me something about the value of this red target. This fixation light is either going to turn red or green after a little delay. That's the roulette game. And if it turns red, the monkey has to look to the right. If it turns green, the monkey has to look to the left. But I'm going to listen in on these area LIP neurons while I systematically vary the value of making this movement. So in the first, let's say, 100 trials, I cartooned it as an orange, but in actual fact, our monkeys like berry fruit juice. They don't like apple juice. It may be a difference between Providence and New York. In this case, the monkey learned 0.3 milliliters of juice for the red target and 0.3 for the left. Here, 0.4 and 0.2. Here, 0.2 and 0.4. So you can see we're systematically varying the value. And we're just going to ask, do the neurons care? And of course, I wouldn't be telling you this story if they didn't. Now what I'm plotting for you is, in red, the average activity of a neuron during a block of trials. This is the moment at which we reveal that we're playing the roulette game. Here is the firing rate, which is quite high when the monkey expects to receive a large reward. And here, when he produces the same movement, the firing rate is quite low when he expects to receive a small reward. See, this is a critical idea because in the Cartesian program, the original philosophical idea was that it's a reflection of something in the environment to something in the action. There's no room for a representation of value or choice in that story. Here, the monkeys are making the same responses, and they're actually seeing the same stimuli. They're just embedded in different belief structures about the value of the world to them. And what this neuron is telling us is something about value. Now, Michael went on to show that it's much more detailed than that. Here, I'm plotting for you the firing rate of the neuron under many different conditions like these. And you can see that as we increase the value of the target in the response field, we increase the value of the movement the neuron is thinking about, the firing rate of the neuron goes up in a very linear, straight-line fashion. Of course, I told you that von Neumann and Morgenstern argued that understanding decision-making is more than value. It's also about understanding probability. So Michael repeated that experiment, now systematically varying the probability that the slot machine would pay off on the right-hand side, from 50 to 80 to 20, and so on. And Michael again produced the same result. A huge amount of activity when the monkey thinks he's highly likely to win. Oh, the neuron, sorry, thinks it's highly likely to win. And a small, lower level of activity when the neuron thinks it's likely not to win. And again, we see this nice linear representation. Okay, so the critical idea here is that when we went in to the interface point between the sensory and motor systems and asked what lay there, was it a mirror? The answer was no. To a first approximation, what lies there is an economic representation. And that was a startling revelation, and it really changed the way we began to think about the decision-making architecture. Now, I want to lay that out for you as a 3D view of how the brain works, but before I do that, I have to tell you a tiny bit more about brain structure. This is a movie I've borrowed from my friend David Van Essen at the Washington University. And here you can see a human brain. It's been reconstructed using structural magnetic resonance imaging. And you'll notice how folded it is. But if we inflate the brain, which of course we can do on a computer, it would be ugly to do this in real life, we reveal that the brain is actually this flat structure, a largely flat structure made in a sheet-like fashion, John mentioned this earlier today, that's just a couple of millimeters thick. Now what we next asked was, what does the representation look like if we go into parietal area LIP, either in humans or monkeys, and try and decode what does it look like when a decision's being made? Now, the first step in that process was to take the brains of a bunch of subjects in the scanner, flatten their brains, and work through a tremendous mathematical system to basically work out what area LIP was encoding in space and time and things like that. I'm actually not going to show you our movie of that because it's really crummy. I'm embarrassed to say. Instead, I'm going to show you my friend Marty Serino's movie, which is really cool. Now, this is an experiment done at the same time. What Marty's showing you here in his movie is this rotating dot. The human beings being asked to make eye movements to this dot, and these maps on the right and left are showing you the flattened cerebral cortex in this area, in the right and left side of the brain.
when the dot reaches the top and sweeps down, dot reaches the top and sweeps down to the left, you'll notice activity sweeps as a wave across this area. And what this reveals to us is that area LIP is in fact a topographic map where every location on the map is a place you can look to in space. And what we're hypothesizing now is that deciding where to look is the process of deciding which of those many movements is the most valuable to you, whether they're eye movements or arm movements. There's a similar structure I'll show you in a moment concerned with arm movements. So let me flesh that out and show you what that looks like. So this is the work of one of my current postdoctoral fellows, Ryan Webb. What you're looking at here on the top is a computer simulation of the neurons of this cortical brain area. There are about 100 neurons here and about 500 neurons across. And what we'll do is ask, what does this map look like when we offer the monkey a juice reward? So here's the juice reward being offered, and you can see a little peak of activity where this chunk of brain is representing the fact that there's something there of value. Now, of course, that implies, and it is definitely the case, that if we offer two things of value, simultaneously we get two peaks of activity that rise up, and that the choice is some arbitration between these two options represented at two different locations on the parietal map. It's also the case that if we change the relative values of the two options, we see a change in the relative heights of these two peaks. You can see here the cartoon apple and orange, and the higher level of activation associated with the apple than the orange, which is the critical tool that the cortex is going to use to identify the high-valued apple and select it. Okay, so how do we put this together, and how do we think about choosing? Remember, our idea from Descartes was that there are sensory inputs, that's a critical point, that come into the brain, and there are motor outputs, and there has to be some point of interaction. Sherrington drew the basic themes when he explained how neurons were connected, how stimuli actually propagate across synapses and through biophysical objects. What Samuelson stressed to us was the critical nature of the underlying representation. It's not enough to have a mirror. What you actually need in order to produce coherent and meaningful choice is a deeper representation, one that preserves all of these standard economic features. And then, of course, finally, what we need to do is actually choose. See if I can make that happen again. No. Come back, little guy. Okay, so here we are at the choice. So we're coming up to the choice, and what actually happens, we now know, is that the level of activity in the map changes quite suddenly. What actually happens is these two peaks, this one and this one, begin to compete for control of the map. They do this through long-range interactions in the cortical map. And eventually, the larger one manages to overwhelm and suppress the smaller one. And once the larger one crosses this little threshold, he actually automatically activates downstream circuits that produce the eye movement. Okay. So I want to stress now in telling you this story that it's not, I've made it sound a little too simple. I've made it sound as if there was one brain area and I got lucky and recorded from it. That is certainly not the case. The process of making a decision involves the interaction of many, many brain areas. We've studied and know of at least three involved in the generation of eye movements, the selection of eye movements, and they are the lateral interparietal area, which I told you about, the frontal eye fields, and the superior colliculus. What we know is that all three of these areas are tightly coupled. Here I'm showing you an example of what might happen in a normal choice. You saw some activity arise first in the area LIP map that then propagates quickly to the frontal eye field and collicular map. Now LIP is driving a choice by bursting its activity, and you can see it's driving in the rest of the network a similar convergence to a single movement that's then executed through outputs coming from this last structure, the superior colliculus. The details here aren't so important, but what I do want you to get is that the data now suggests pretty clearly that there's an economic level representation in lots of places in the brain, that these areas interact, and that choice is the process of one or more of these areas forcing a competition amongst options so that only one option comes to dominate all the activity in the system. Now, I told you that in the eye movement system, we've done quite a few experiments in the arm movement system. We've, of course, lots of other people have done great work in the arm movement system, including John, who talked about his work this morning. But I could tell you a similar story there with a cluster of areas that have essentially the same features in them.
Okay, at this point, I think a reasonable criticism of the story is, okay, I get it. A monkey choosing beriberi fruit juice, 3 or 6 milliliters. That is kind of not what I did when I chose my wife, and I'm not entirely convinced that you've told me something useful for more complicated behaviors. So for us, the next critical step was to move away from these sort of dopey little problems to richer and richer problems. And most interesting would be to move away from problems that seemed reflexy, really simple, to problems that were complicated, that were harder, and ultimately that were strategic. Now, as an economist, there's one tool for doing that, and that is the theory of games developed by John von Neumann and John Nash, the Nobel Prize-winning mathematician and economist. You know, I used to actually have a picture here of Russell Crowe. Many of you know that Russell Crowe plays John Nash in the movie A Beautiful Mind, and someone took me aside and said, you know, John is really offended when you do that. And I have to say, I am puzzled by that. I wish I could have convinced Tom to put a picture of Russell Crowe up for my bio, but I get it and I respect it. Okay, so I'm going to give you two insights from game theory. They're really important insights. The first one is the one Nash won the Nobel Prize for. And the intuition is going to be this: if you and I were playing rock, paper, scissors, why would I pick rock every time? Well, I pick rock every time because I believed it was better, that on average it yielded a higher outcome. Why would I pick scissors every time? Because I believed it was better. Why would I mix it up? Why would I sometimes pick rock and sometimes pick paper in an unpredictable way? Well, Nash proved that I would only do that if my internal representation suggested that the value of rock and paper was exactly the same. When these two things are exactly the same, behavior should mix it up, but when they're not, behavior should pick the best thing. I think that's kind of obvious. The thing that's a little counterintuitive is that Nash showed this was true even when the optimal strategy is to, let's say, play rock 20% of the time and scissor 80% of the time. This is true not only at the 50-50 point, but even at asymmetric points. And it's a little counterintuitive why that should be so, so I'm just going to ask you to take my word for that. Okay, so my postdoctoral fellow Mike Doris and I, Mike is now a full professor at Queen's University in Canada, began to explore this using a pretty famous old Cold War level game called the work or shirk game. Now, I'll tell you how we think about it in the lab. There are two players, and this is a grid of their payoffs. The employer we like to think of as the graduate student's mentor, and the employee we like to think of as the graduate student. So the graduate student, every morning when he wakes up, has to decide between going to work and laying in bed, which we call working and shirking. If he goes to work, he earns 50 cents. Now, this is actually pretty accurate if you've been a graduate student. If he lays in bed, he either makes zero if he gets caught, or he makes one whole dollar. We think of this as in he goes and works his other job at Burger King for another 50 cents, assuming that the mentor doesn't inspect. So here's the payoff matrix for the worker. And the employer, the graduate mentor, see, for him, the best place in this world is right up here. He doesn't waste any money inspecting, any time. He stays at home. This is what most graduate mentors want to do, right? And the graduate student comes in every day. Alternatively, he can inspect, but that costs him money. You can think of that as his car fare or something. And it's the balance between these costs and benefits that drives the equilibrium behavior. Now, remember, what Nash showed was that under conditions of equilibrium, that is, whenever they're mixing it up, regardless of what level they're mixing it up at, the underlying representation ought to be that the value of the two options is identical. But von Neumann took that a step farther. He actually did it first and pointed out that another really interesting feature of human game behavior is that they're unpredictable. This is the fundamental voluntary nature of human games. You can't predict round to round whether the person you're playing with will say rock or paper or scissors. Von Neumann was fascinated by that. Here I'm showing you a human playing our game. This is the probability that they'll shirk as a function of the round number. The gray lines are actually the Nash equilibrium solutions. You'll notice they're discontinuous because here we raise the cost of inspection. Drop the cost of inspection, sorry. And here you can see the behavior of a typical NYU undergraduate. And what I want you to notice is that it jiggles around. The NYU undergraduate is doing just what he should, which is to be unpredictable. So these are the two features I think we want to capture if we want to move forward. The notion that people are unpredictable when they engage in voluntary behaviors, not like the monkeys picking the juice drops. And the second thing I really want to capture is this notion of identity, that the underlying representation should show the same level as long as we're at an equilibrium state. Okay, now, thinking about this, I need to tell you one other weird fact about the nervous system. When neurobiologists talk about the nervous system, they have a tendency to treat these neurons as if they were, well, little automata, like the Milliardet guy who always draws his picture of the sailboat in exactly the same way. And that is by no means the case. Neurons, in fact, are highly variable devices. When a neurophysiologist says to you, this neuron fired 100 spikes per second, neurophysiologists like to say stuff like that. And then they usually say something like, drrrr, that's supposed to be what it sounds like. In fact, they're lying to you. What the neuron is actually doing is going, which on average is, you get the idea. Thank you. This is actually why you go to graduate school, to learn to do that. There's not a neurophysiologist. I should get John to go. We could do a duet. Okay. So this is a figure from Tony Movshin's work. And here what we're plotting is the average activity of a neuron in cortex against its variability. And what I want you to see is that as the neurons become more active, they become more variable, not less. This is a really weird feature of cortical neurons. Cortical neurons are really unpredictable. And so what Mike Doris and I wanted to ask was whether or not we could put these facts together in a way that would explain behavior even in something as complicated as the inspection game. Now, we've studied that game in humans to death. We've also studied it in monkeys to death. I'm going to ask you today to take my word for it that those two games are basically the same, that humans and monkeys play them identically, that monkeys can beat humans about as much as humans can beat monkeys. That's disappointing, but it's true. In fact, when I say that, sometimes older economists, when I'm at large universities, get up and walk out. Like, forget it. Okay, so here's what Mike did. He trained a monkey to play work or shirk. He actually trained several monkeys to play work or shirk. And here's what work or shirk looks like to a monkey. So we're going to record from a single neuron, and that neuron is thinking about the value of the target at this location. So the monkey's staring straight ahead. Two targets come up. The light goes out. When it comes back on yellow, he has to decide whether he wants to work, that's get half a milliliter of juice for sure, or shirk, take his chance on his opponent. Now, in this case, his opponent is a computer simulation of a human being. He'll either get one or zero. Depending on the cost of inspection, there'll be different equilibria. So sometimes the monkeys will be shirking 10% of the time, sometimes 50, sometimes 80, but they basically understand how to do this, and they nail the Nash equilibrium solutions quite well. So then the first question is, was Nash right? Can we look in the brain and see evidence that as we change the equilibrium state from 10% to 50% to 80% to 90% shirking, the neural activity shouldn't change? It's this weird prediction of the Nash equilibrium theorem. And in fact, that's exactly what we found. Here you can see the average activity of a neuron in white when the monkey's choosing to shirk 10% of the time, all the way down to black when the monkey's choosing to shirk 70% of the time. These neurons never change their firing rates when at equilibrium, exactly as predicted by these high-level game theoretic explanations for human behavior. But even more interesting to me is not this global average, but what they do on every round. Remember, on every round, the monkey's switching. He's mixing it up. Sometimes he's working, sometimes he's shirking. And the question is, can we find evidence of that process? And the answer is yes. Here, I'm plotting the probability that he'll choose to shirk as a function of round number. In gray are these Nash equilibrium mathematically predicted solutions. In black, the behavior of the monkey, you can see that when we change the conditions, he figures that out and hits the optimum, changes it and hits this efficient solution, changes it, hits this efficient solution, you get the idea. And on average, the firing rate of the neuron is fixed. The little red dots show the average firing rate of the neuron on that trial. But notice that the little red dots fluctuate. And it turns out that these local fluctuations are highly correlated with the behavior of the monkey on each trial. On trials in which they fluctuate up, he's much more likely to shirk. And on trials in which they fluctuate down, he's much less likely to shirk. So we see both of the features we're looking for here.
This standard economic theory represented in the living tissue of the monkey's deciding brain, and the unpredictability or variability represented by the variability of the cortical neurons. This is how we think about that in the lab. What I'm showing you here is that task simulated, and what I want you to see is these two peaks fluctuating back and forth. They're roughly equivalent, but they're fluctuating up and down, and it's this random fluctuation, this changes in the firing rates of the neurons, which seem to be driving the unpredictable behavior the monkey, and we believe the humans, are expressing, even under these rich circumstances. Okay, so now I've given you what I hope is a decent outline of the structure of the brain that makes choices. We now have evidence that many brain areas have these properties. We basically know how they're connected. I'll show you a connection diagram in a moment. But what seems to be the case is that there are these maps of your options. And the activity at each location on each of those maps tells you what that option's worth to you. And the units that that's encoded in are action potentials per second, or as John pointed out, for some strange historic reason, we all like to say spikes because it's cooler. So in spikes per second. And the spikes per second are fluctuating because neurons are noisy devices, because they're unpredictable, because they're stochastic. And we can see that when we take a look at a graph like this, where we can see the peaks actually competing. And the should I work, should I shirk, should I work, should I shirk being played out in the neural architecture of the monkey brain. Now for us, that was really only the first step. Because that's kind of, I had a friend, an economist friend at Dartmouth who once said to me, okay, so all the economic theories are instantiated in the brain, and there's a mechanism that chooses. So we win, that was the economists win, and who cares? We don't need you anymore. So I thought that was a good criticism. And of course, the critical question is not, from the economist's point of view, how is it mechanically implemented downstream of the classical theory? The question is, how is the representation of value, which we see here, constructed by the human mind? That's really going to be the interesting thing. Now, we know quite a bit about how that works now. We know that there are at least 5, 6, 7 main areas that work together, largely in the frontal cortex and some in the basal ganglia, which Helen talked about yesterday, in the amygdala, that work together to construct valuations. I'm going to tell you a little bit about that story, but I want to capture an interesting and important fact before I do that, and that is the notion of that we're all idiosyncratic in our preferences. This is a really important point that you want the theory and the observation to capture. Some of you like apples, some of you like oranges more. Some of you are patient, some of you are impulsive. If I offer a tray of different foods, each one of you will take a different food from the tray. And of course, that's the critical feature that we want to find the neural implementation of. We want to understand what in your brain is different that makes you like the chocolate cake and someone else like the pecan pie. A place we decided to first study this was in the area, a domain called time discounting or intertemporal choice. Imagine I ask you whether you'd rather have $20 now, I want to give you this one, there we go, $20 now or $22 in 30 days. Someone who's extremely patient might say, I'd be happy to wait the extra 30 days to have two more dollars. Someone who's impulsive might say, you know, there's no way I'm waiting. Most of our NYU undergraduates are in this category. But people change during their lifespan. All of us are different. People have different degrees of impulsivity in regard to this. And we thought this would be a really interesting place to begin to explore because the range of human variation is so large. We could ask, can we find the neural basis of that range of variation, figure out where value is represented and how it projects up to these choice areas we've been studying before. Now, the way to think about this problem is to think about the value of a gain, let's make it money for the moment, as declining as we go away from ourselves in time. So here's a rat. He's trying to decide between one food pellet now and some larger amount of food pellets at a later delay. And we can mathematically compute the rate at which the value of a pellet declines as a function of time. These are actually seconds. You can see that pigeons are more impulsive about millet seed than rats are about little rat pellets. This is a monkey making a decision about water. I have to admit that this little line here is me making a decision about water. My lab loves this because it implies that I'm just a tiny bit more impulsive than our monkeys. So what we want to basically do is trace out this curve. And the point I want to make is that this curve is different for everybody. So we're going to have to trace it out separately for everybody. And then we're going to try and figure out the brain circuitry that gives rise to your particular curve, your decline in value with time. This is the work of an old postdoc of mine by the name of Joe Cable. Joe's now a first-year assistant professor at the University of Pennsylvania. So what Joe did was have subjects crawl into a brain scanner, and he asked them to make this choice. While they're staring straight ahead in the brain scanner, they're asked, would you rather have $20 now or, and then on every round a different number and delay appear here, or $40 in 30 days, $60 in 30 days. Now let me add that these are all for real. These human volunteers are making these decisions. We'll randomly select four of them and realize them. If you picked $120 in 60 days, you will go home with a little Visa card, a little Visa debit card, and in 180 days, we will load that money onto your Visa card. So it's all for real. So we're pretty well loved, I have to say, at NYU, because we basically give away money. Okay, so here's a single chooser. What I'm plotting for you now is one subject, subject RA. The probability that he'll decide to wait for the larger amount when he's being asked to wait 90 days for that larger amount. And here on the lower axis, I'm just plotting how much we're offering him. So if we say, what would you rather have, $20 now or $22 in 3 months? He says, give me the 20 now. 30, 35, and here at around 42, he switches and says, you know, I'll wait for that. Now, those of you who know anything about finance know this is a truly horrendous state of affairs. His switch point is a 400% annual interest rate. But it turns out that that's not unusual. Okay, so we can ask him this question, not just at 90 days, but at many different delays. And this allows us to construct one of these curves that shows how the value of money declines for him as we move through time. Now, what I want to stress is how idiosyncratic this is. So here are the first 10 subjects we studied extensively. This subject, subject YH, she's everybody in my lab's favorite. She is incredibly, you'll notice how flat that line is. Money doesn't lose value to her. Perhaps unsurprisingly, she is an MD, PhD student. And here, subject CH, he's a really troubling character in a way. Money loses half of its value to him in about 10 days. Joe actually asked me if he could collect this point on the graph, and I asked how much it would cost, and he said $6,000. CH is, ironically, is a semi-professional skydiver. All right, so now what do we do? We had you lying in the brain scanner. We've gotten a sense of what your idiosyncratic value for delay of money is. And now we do a really interesting trick, I think, that Joe dreamed up. We go back to the MRI trials, the data when you were lying in the brain scanner, and we say, hey, look, on this trial, we offered you $40 in 20 days. That should be, I should be able to use your curve to sort of calibrate that and figure out how much that $40 has lost in value by that delay. For some, that'll be a lot. For others, that'll be a little. And then we can go into the brain of each individual separately and ask, where is this guy's internal representation of value located? So here's RH, and what we find is that his internal representation of value is strongly located here in this brain region, the medial prefrontal cortex. This is going to turn out to be the most important area. And the second most important area is this, the ventral striatum. I'm going to not talk today about this third area, the posterior cingulate. But here's the interesting thing. Here are five different people. So here's crazy CH. The value for money for him drops incredibly fast. And this brain area, the medial prefrontal cortex, drops its valuation of money incredibly fast too. This subject, HM, is incredibly patient when it comes to money. And his medial prefrontal cortex is incredibly patient. What we see is the same brain areas in all of the subjects we've ever examined. Let me stress, we're not getting the same activation in these brain areas. We're getting an activation that predicts how patient you are, that tells me how much you value it. If you're someone who values an immediate gain, this is a highly active area for immediate gains only. If you're someone who's patient and values a delayed gain, this is a brain area which reflects that patience. And we've done experiments like these in a number of systems, and the rules generally turn out to be that this region, the medial prefrontal cortex, and this region, the ventral striatum, are the two critical areas where our preferences are constructed. Those are the places where what we love and what we hate come to be represented. Now, if that's really true, I ought to be able to go a step further, and I ought to be able to do the fabulous trick of sticking someone in a brain scanner, actually figuring out what they like without asking them any questions, and then predicting what they'll choose. This strikes us as sort of the gold standard test. And this is an experiment that was conducted a couple years ago by my students, Ifat Levy, now an assistant professor at Yale, and my current student, Stephanie Lazzaro. What Stephanie and Ifat did was identify a group of about 20 consumer goods. I'm just showing a bunch of them to you here. And what they're going to do now is they're going to show these consumer goods to human subjects while they lie in our brain scanner, and we're just going to see how active their medial prefrontal cortex and ventral striatum are while they watch those goods go by. They're going to watch each good go by 12 times. That'll give us a little bit more signal-to-noise ratio. And then we're going to try and use the activation to each good to predict what they'll do when we take them out of the scanner and ask them to make choices amongst these goods. So the basic experiment looks like this. I'm going to skip these for now. You're lying in the scanner. You see the DVD Madagascar. There's a delay. Nothing happens. The next good appears. Repeat, repeat, repeat. Every so often, we ask them something about that to keep them focused on target, to make sure that they're interested. And this is really important in brain scanners, to make sure they don't fall asleep. You would be surprised how many a good experiment was wrecked by a sleeping undergraduate at $400 an hour. Okay, so here's what you get. Here we're looking at the activity of one subject's medial prefrontal cortex. I'm plotting the brain activation to this little moleskin notebook. I actually never heard of these before, but I gather they are totally cool. And you can see a high activation to the moleskin notebook. Now this poor fellow shows an extremely low activation to this Mozart CD, or Beethoven CD. That's troubling. But you know, it says something about NYU. Don't worry about it here. And here for two intermediate goods. All right, so what can we do with this kind of data? What we can do with this kind of data is we can rank order the goods neurally. This is the thing he liked most. And here's the Beethoven CD, which he liked the least. He kind of likes Gustav Klimt okay, but you learn a lot about people. He likes the movie Dodgeball. It's a little troubling. Okay. It's terrible to come to my lab, because you know people do this. Okay, so now after we've got this neural ranking, we pull him out of the scanner, and now we ask them to make some choices. They're not in the brain scanner at all. So we show them every pairwise choice that could be constructed from these 20 goods. Which would you rather have, Madagascar or this Monet? You can guess what this kid picked. This Nora Jones CD or A Thousand Suns, the book. This little planner or this Akon CD. The Akon CD is really interesting. It's a rap CD, and I had also not heard of Akon. But it's a great neural device because people, it's either your first or your last neural activation. Nobody kind of goes in the middle on the Akon CDs. Okay, so now what are we going to do? What we're going to do next is we're going to take a look at the rank ordering, and we're going to break up the comparisons into 19 types. Whenever we're asking a question about the highest versus the lowest, well, those should be the easy ones, right? We should really be able to predict what people are going to do. So we're going to call those a neural distance of 19. And at a neural distance of 19, if anything I've told you is true, we ought to be able to predict people's choices. Of course, at a neural distance of 1, I can construct lots of neural distance 1 pairs. You know, the brain isn't really showing a clear signal here about which is better, and it's not clear that the person knows which is better for them. So we ought to expect to not be able to predict very well. That should be a feature of getting it right. And in fact, that's what we find. Here's one human subject shown here, but I'm showing you group data from 20 people who are involved in this experiment. Here's the probability that we'll get it right as a function of how far apart in neural activations the goods were. You'll notice that when the goods are far apart, we can get it right almost 90% of the time. And this is, most of the undergraduates find this really creepy. But as we get closer and closer in the brain's representation of their desirability, we see that our prediction goes finally to chance. And we think that's really because their preference difference is going to chance. Okay.
So what have I told you today? Descartes brought to the table for physiologists the idea that we ought to study something about decision making, how you get from sensation to action. And his idea was that that was about some mechanical coupling. And I don't want to make that sound dumb. I want you to think about that little automata drawing that little picture. A mechanical coupling, but not a very interesting one in the intellectual sense, even if it might have been quite interesting in the mechanical sense. But if we bring to the table a bunch of other ideas, we get a much richer view of what's going on. People like Samuelson and von Neumann and Morgenstern and Nash laid out the modern theory of economics, and it tells us, in principle, I think it tells us what the brain's representation would have to look like if we were economic organisms, and we are. And in fact, as we've gone into the brain, not only have we found evidence that they were essentially correct, but we've been able to tease apart the mechanism that actually makes the choices, does the representation, and I've told you only the tiniest bit of the mountains of data that are available today about this process. So let me leave you with then this cartoon that I think will capture the bulk of what I've told you today. And we think of this as the standard model for human choice as of right now. So here's a human brain looking at some screen, and I offer this human a choice between a pear and an apple. Now, I guess this is Tom, because I want the apple to be the more desirable good. We know that a bunch of areas I haven't talked to you about, this is the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, the orbitofrontal cortex, and the amygdala, carry representations of the values of these goods. You'll notice here the sort of intrinsic value seems to be represented. I've cartooned it. More activity, a larger apple than a pear. We know that the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex is critical when people are self-controlling, when they're avoiding foods they shouldn't eat, when they're trying to make healthy choices, when they're being patient. So you might imagine that Tom thinks that pears are better for him, so there's sort of a little effort here by the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex to force him to the pear. The amygdala, we know, is important in suppressing activity, reducing value, particularly in response to fearful experiences. The fact that last time Tom reached for an apple at a provost meeting, he got slapped, leads to an enhanced representation there, which is going to sort of decrease the representation of the apple centrally. But all of these lead finally to a joint representation in the medial prefrontal cortex and the ventral striatum where the relative values to you are encoded. And the critical idea here is if you're someone who likes pears more than apples, this is the opposite representation in you. We can tell what you're going to like. We can tell how patient you're going to be by looking at these brain structures. And we know that once those choice options have been identified, they're passed to the choice network, which working across many brain areas, all closely coupled, builds a representation of the choice set and then forces a choice. In this case, again, I'm cartooning the choice coming here out of area LIP first, which then converges this global network on the option you've selected and activates the movement control circuitry necessary to achieve that goal. All right, so what I hope I've left you with is something, let's say, optimistic. 15 years ago, we really didn't know the first thing about how people choose. And today, I think we have a pretty solid standard model understanding of how it is that information percolates through the system. The most exciting thing for me is that that understanding really doesn't come from economics. It really doesn't come from psychology. It really doesn't come from neuroscience. It comes uniquely from the intersection of those three fields. You see, in each aspect of this work, critical components that could only have been contributed by their parent discipline. I think this is really the model for future neuroscience when we engage really hard problems like the ones Annie was talking about in the theory of neuroscience and music, where we have to take interdisciplinary insights. Neuroscientists need to be receptive to the fact that economists who've been studying choice for 300 years know something, tempting though it may be to dismiss them. Economists need to be open to the fact that the brain's an important part of our economic architecture. That hasn't generally been true, but it's coming to be true, and I hope I've convinced you that it's very powerful when it does happen. Let me just finish by thanking the many institutes and foundations that have supported our work over the years, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Glimcher, for that illuminating lecture. I still can't decide if I like apples or pears better, but at least now I know what Tom likes. We'll gather our panel up in the front again for our question and answer period. Please get a question card from an usher if you wish to ask a question and pass it forward. Thank you.
Good to go. So thank you very much for a wonderful talk, Dr. Glimcher. Can we start with some questions from the panel? Anybody? Go for it, John.
Why do you make a decision?
Because we tell you to. No, that's a great question. So we think about decisions as having a couple of different features in this regard. A lot of the time you're told, here are your options, choose. And that's really the decision situation we've studied the most. There are other neurobiological labs which have studied what you can think of as speeded or immediate or reaction time decisions, where what's actually happening is the monkey's being told, choose as quick as you can. Now, it looks like the same networks are operating, whether we're asking the monkey to take his time and then decide, or go as fast as you can and then decide. What changes about the network is the nature of the competition between those different peaks. What we think is going on, and it works beautifully in simulation, we're in the process of trying to prove that it's really what happens in the tissue, is that the network can basically be set not to converge, so the peaks don't interact very much. Then when you face a bunch of options, they're naturally represented on these maps, and nothing happens until you say, monkey, choose now, or human, choose now. At that point, the network allows this interaction, this long-range interaction, this long-range inhibitory interaction, Although we actually think it's probably, in the models, it's often, there's a fight about whether it's a long-range inhibitory action or a long-range excitatory action. In the reaction time things, what we actually think is that the network is preset to sort of have a threshold, a good enough response. And once one of those two peaks crosses the good enough, it actually exerts enough influence over the whole map to force the map to converge and drive the movement. So you can think of this as an adjustable threshold, this degree of competition between different elements in the map. If you've got to go really, 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 really fast, you set that really low. And if you have time to think about it, represent it, you can set it really high. And you can even set it so high that nothing will happen. I mean, I do this a lot, and you stew over the decision for 2 weeks. And then finally, when your provost says, you know, decide, then the network converges in whatever current state it's at. So this pushes back, now I pushed back your real question, which I'm aware I did, which is, okay, who tells it to decide? I mean, the fact that I say decide to the monkey, we don't actually know the neural pathway that connects the decide now command to this global inhibitory or excitatory flush across the network. And that's a really big question. We're very interested in the idea that cortical oscillations may be involved in that. This is an area of great controversy and active research in the coordination of activity across many brain areas. But I think we just don't have a clue yet what is the propagator of that change in state.
Helen? So can you study this concept in the absence of reward? I mean, I know in animals, you know, how would you know, but how one could imagine that one makes decisions in the absence of reward as you've conceptualized it. How do you think it always requires reward to make a decision?
Well, so I'm going to reveal that I'm an economist, okay? And that is, anything someone picks, we like to say in economics, they have revealed, they have preferred.
Okay.
But that comes with some theoretical freight. It means that if I honestly give you the choice between eating chocolate cake, you know, piles and piles of chocolate cake, and eating a salad, and you eat the salad, to an economist, you have revealed that you preferred the salad, and that it was more rewarding in an operational sense. Now, this does fail to capture something. I'm aware of that.
Big time.
And the evidence we have right now is that the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, this area of your brain right up about here, is critical in this story. It seems to be the one that down-regulates activity in the medial areas in response to these sort of long-term goals. So my short answer is, if you reveal you prefer it, you preferred it. It is weird, some of the things people prefer, like salads.
Chocolate cake.
Yeah.
John is thinking the opposite. I don't believe that one bit. But we think that that has to do with an interaction of multiple brain areas, and you're right, and in some sort of like glucose rewardy sense, the chocolate cake's got it all over the salad, even if you reveal you prefer the salad. And so it's understanding that interaction that we're working on right now.
I'm interested in the connections between your work and evolutionary psychology. And I'm wondering, when you do rats and pigeons, do you get as much variability from one individual to another as you get with humans? I would suspect that you don't. And I also understand that you can explain temporal discounting evolutionarily, because if you've got to wait a month for something and you're an animal that's probably not going to live that long, you're smart to grab it when you can. So two questions. Do you get the same variability in animals as you do in humans? And given that we're so genetically similar, do you think genetics can account for the huge difference between your two, the subjects at the two different ends of your spectrum?
Okay, let me do the easier one first. About variability, the answer is I have no idea. Game theoretic studies on non-humans are extremely rare. There have been some game theoretic studies of honeybees, foraging. We've done some of the most extensive, we and Mike Doris have done some of the most extensive studies, and we've only done rhesus macaques. So a really good controlled study of that, I agree, is really interesting. My bias is that anything with a cortex is going to look about the same, and anything without a cortex is going to look really different. But that's just a guess, because we think that the variability has its origin in this nature of cortex. Okay, so now the discounting phenomenon is really interesting. Why is it that people discount so steeply, the value of goods falls so fast? And there's a standard evolutionary answer, which is we evolved in a world where fruit doesn't last 30 years. We don't discount at 5%, which is what once upon a time we used to think of as the US T-bill rate. Now, of course, that's not true anymore. You can tell who in the room laughed. It's kind of interesting. So why don't we discount at that rate? Maybe because we're used to foods that are perishable. That's a really interesting idea. We discount a lot slower for money than we do for food. There's no comparison. Humans discount for food pretty much like other animals in our experience. But they discount for money 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 orders of magnitude more, and they should be discounting 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 orders of magnitude more. So that's weird. I don't have much insight on that. I do know that a lot of the variability has huge clinical impact. We know, for example, that drug addicts are people who have incredibly steep discount functions. They value immediate to delayed gains. People who are chronic smokers, nicotine users, they also are extremely steep discounters. Children are steeper discounters than adults. So there are interesting lifetime patterns. There are interesting disease-related profiles. We don't really know the extent to which this is genetic. There have been efforts to search for that, and there are some relations between dopamine genes and discount rate, but they're not very strong. So I think there'll probably be a genetic component and an epigenetic component, and they'll be all small. Mm-hmm. That's kind of a crummy answer, okay. Though. I'm sorry.
No, that's great. Thanks.
I have a question about the meaning of value in your theory. So I think this is an Oscar Wilde-ism. He said, I think it was him, perhaps Bernard Shaw, I'm not sure, some witty English person, said, a cynic is someone who knows the price of everything and the value of nothing. And you could say an economist is somebody. Anyway, that points up an interesting distinction. And I'm impressed that, you know, value in your experiments certainly goes beyond just money. You know, it's beriberi juice, it's, CDs and Moleskines. But what about values like, country, family? I mean, if somebody said, how much money would you, ask to be able to, do something terrible to your daughter, I'd say, that does not compute, right? Are there...
I'm going to tell you a story that you're going to love, Mark.
Okay.
Okay, so this is a great question. And the best experiment is one by Michael Platt, my old student at Duke. So Michael is originally by training an anthropologist, and he's really interested in how monkeys see the world and how monkeys see each other. And he's known for years that monkeys like to look at pictures of other monkeys. And so he thought, I wonder if I could get monkeys to pay in juice to look at other monkeys. So what he did is he went to his own monkey colony, and he took pictures of the faces of all the monkeys. He took, I think, 150 pictures of each monkey, so it would be, you wouldn't have some artifact of the structure of one of the pictures. And then in the experiment, what would happen is the monkey would be shown a little teeny thumbnail image on the center of the screen of one of the other monkeys in the colony, and then two targets would appear. And if he chose the left, he would get to view that picture for 10 seconds. And if he chose the right, he'd be paid in juice. Now, the idea was you would adjust the amount of juice you paid them so that you'd know what each individual in the colony was worth in milliliters of juice. Okay? Now, so they did this, and the first thing they did is they showed high-ranking monkeys, pictures of high-ranking monkeys. And monkeys paid a lot to look at their betters, which was interesting. And then they put up a picture of a low-ranking monkey, and they couldn't get the monkeys to look at them. And it turned out you had to pay the monkeys to look at them. Just fantastic. Okay. So then he is able to set the value for all these individuals. I should add that the one place where this story didn't work, this is an aside, but it's irresistible, was these are all boy monkeys. They live with some girl monkeys who live in separate cages. And when they showed them the faces of the girl monkeys, they didn't want to look at them. And you had to pay them a lot to look at the girl monkeys, even the high-ranking girl monkeys, which was puzzling, until one of the anthropologists in Michael's lab said, you're showing them the wrong end of the girl monkey. So, they went back and they took some new pictures of the girl monkeys. And it turns out there's not actually enough beriberi fruit juice in the world. Okay, but so here's the neuroscience.
So that wasn't quite the uplifting answer I was hoping for. But
okay. Anyway, calm down. Okay, so now here's the interesting thing. Now you have, and as an economist, I'd say you've monetized the value of an image of every monkey in the colony. And you also have money that's juice for these guys. And now we can go into area LIP and ask, well, how strong is the response in an LIP neuron when it's choosing between this monkey face, this juice? And if everything I've told you is true, I ought to be able to predict the firing rates to the monkey pictures from their monetized juice values. And you can.
Wow.
That's cool, right? This paper was called Monkey Pay-Per-View.
Thank you. So in other words, these relationships that you're seeing really do extend to sort of interpersonal or inter-monkey social things too, apropos Larry's talk yesterday with... Mm-hmm. Okay.
And we've found that in social games, when people are competing in games like the ones I showed you, this is mostly work by Liz Phelps' lab, a lab down the street, down the hall from mine. Liz has shown that if we tell you the guy you're going to be playing with is a bad guy, you behave differently towards him, and the neural representation shifts appropriately in all of these areas. So it really does look like, at this point, we're down pretty far down in the system of the choosing and valuation. Now, I mean, your intuitions, I think, are all right, but they're all going to be much more towards the front of the head, and they're going to be up past this common area I was talking about today, the medial prefrontal cortex.
Gotcha. Cool. Any
questions? So I'm
curious how what... Wait, you're not on. They don't like you. They never turn your mic on.
All right, there we go. Okay, good. What role novelty-seeking plays in these theories? So there are people, when they go to restaurants, they'll order something they never tried just because it's new, and they don't know if they like it or not. And so how does that, those kinds of behaviors and circuits play into your...
That's a great question, too. It's a great question because we are in the process of a 5-year longitudinal study for the National Institutes of Aging on just that question. Okay, so... It turns out that for an adult my age, I am, like most adults my age, weakly risk averse. If I face some risk, I'll avoid it. You have to pay me to take on a risk. You don't have to pay me too much, but you have to pay me a little to take on a risk. And we know that risk aversion changes over the lifespan. Older people tend to be a little bit more risk averse than younger people. There's another feature in this, which is usually called ambiguity aversion. This is, how do you feel about situations where I don't reveal to you what the risk is? So we can construct lotteries or tasks where the situation, the state of the world, is ambiguous to you, mm-hmm. and you have to make a decision about what to do. You can take the certain outcome or the ambiguous risk. It turns out people hate ambiguity. They hate it. And you often have to pay people ridiculous amounts of money to tolerate very small degrees of ambiguity. Now, we've been looking across the lifespan, and it turns out that a real feature of adolescence turns out to be ambiguity tolerance. When you're younger and you know less about the world, mm-hmm. our view is that you make those random choices, but you're not afraid of ambiguous things you don't understand so much. In fact, in our hands, and this is pretty controversial, we don't actually think adolescents are particularly risky or risk-seeking. We think they're pretty much like everybody else in their risk attitude, but that they tolerate ambiguity extremely well. So I think that that's a propensity that our data says tails down over the lifespan. As you move from adolescence to young adulthood to midlife, your degree of ambiguity tolerance declines. But I think that has a good evolutionary biology feel to it, because as you're learning about the world, you can, you know, you don't need to take risks so much. And we're working on, so I guess I should say something neurobiologically. So we're also doing that study in the scanner, and we know that ambiguity is also represented in all these areas. That if you're ambiguity averse, these areas are ambiguity averse. If you're ambiguity tolerant, these are. We're really hunting to see whether there is a morphological, a brain structure difference that changes over the course of the lifespan, that tracks and within subject level changes in ambiguity attitude. Don't have it yet. But all the structures I've told you about seem to reflect those features as well.
So neuroeconomics is it's a hot, new, exciting field. And I wonder if you can speculate 30 years from now what impact understanding the sort of the neuroscience of decision making may have on, say, economics or the business world or.
Yeah, that's a good question. So, I mean, I get asked this question by economists all the time because, I should say probably, Annie wanted me to say this earlier, that there's a big fight in the economic community about whether neuroeconomics is relevant. So far, what we've mostly done is shown the relevance of economic theory to neuroscience. We've only just begun to pull a few examples out where we took a theory from economics that didn't work terribly well, and we sort of tuned it up based on an understanding of the brain dynamics. I think you're going to see more and more of that. There are a few really big ticket items in economics that we do not understand. One is a phenomenon called the reference point. It's the observation that we value gains and losses relative to some arbitrary and moving status quo or bias or reference point. You often see, for example, that in a large corporation, somebody is unrealistically expecting a $30,000 raise, somebody else is realistically expecting a $10,000 raise, they both get $20,000 raises, they both have the same salary, they both have the same seniority. The one who expected the $30,000 raise quits in disgust. The guy who expected the $10,000 raise is really happy. And so we want their brains to reflect that fact. Our economic theories can't handle that, not at all. So that's puzzling. And we think that a bunch of labs think that they're pretty close to cracking the nut on that one, and that it will come from the theory of efficient encoding in cortex. If that, the problem of self-control, how it is that we weight the salad versus the chocolate cake, it's another area that economic theory has really failed. If neuroscience can answer a couple of those really big problems, then I think we'll really have a seat at the table, you know, like at the Fed. But I think that that's a little bit off yet.
Any other questions from the panel? Quite a few from the audience, actually. The first one is, it's an interesting one here. If you're using undergraduates for your research subjects, does the delayed development of prefrontal cortex affect your results?
This is such a good question. So we know this is mostly the work of many people, but most famously Jay Guide. Many of you have probably seen his images on, I guess it was last week's National Geographic magazine, the adolescent developing brain. We know that the brain doesn't really reach full development until you're in your mid-20s. Okay, so that's important. Now, we know more about the neuroeconomic behavior of undergraduates and monkeys than about average citizens. And that's a problem, right? So the National Institute of Aging, which has been instrumental in the first 10 years of neuroeconomics, is really stressed out about this. One of their chief program officers, a woman by the name of Liz Nielsen, has been stomping around, knocking on everyone's door, saying, you know, please, who cares about white, middle-class American college students? And this lifetime study I mentioned is one of the few broad efforts to make an effort to look across a broad slice of our population and try and understand how that works. I think that there is a growing awareness that this is a problem that the questioner points up. There are now at least 5 labs working actively to get out of the undergraduate population. And I think we'll get there, but the truth of the matter is it's going to take time.
Another good question here is obviously it's an animal question. So if you can look at parts of the brain and predict which one will win, can you stimulate and make one win?
Yes, you can do that. That was a great question. I probably should have shown that because it's kind of cool. You can do that a bunch of different ways. In the monkeys, we can bias the monkey to choose, let's say, the right-hand one by artificially activating that part of the brain. There's some whole story here. If you gave Helen a bunch of traders and she implanted electrodes into them, she might be able to control the stock exchange in some interesting way. Now, in the humans, the way we can do this is we can disrupt activity using a technology called transcranial magnetic stimulation, where we basically apply an oscillating magnetic field to the surface of the cerebral cortex and deactivate a brain area. This is actually how we know the salad story, Helen, which is if we deactivate the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, people are more likely to pick the chocolate cake. So that's kind of interesting because it suggests that the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex is actively, in a causal way, engaged in the self-control process. So some of those experiments have been done. The stimulation ones in the monkeys all work fine. The trick is figuring out how to do it in the humans.
Cool. So someone has a question about the paradox of choice. So if you have too many choices, nobody wins?
Yeah. What's the story here? This is my favorite thing. Someone I know must have asked this question. So here's the paradox of choice.
One more question.
The most famous example of it is by a Columbia researcher by the name of Sheena Iyengar. So what Sheena did was she went to an upscale New York supermarket and she set out six brands of a well-loved jelly. This is one of these fancy British jelly companies that makes a zillion jellies. And she's wearing a little frock and she says, you wouldn't know that she's this famous PhD researcher, and she says, would you like to try my jellies? And people come up and say, oh yeah, sure, and she makes them a cracker, and they taste each of the jellies, and then she hands them a coupon, and she says, I'll give you $1 off if you want to buy one of these at the cashier, you just have to write your email address on it. Okay, so she does that, and about 30% of the people who come to her little booth taste the jellies, go home and buy the jelly, and then she calls them, and she says, do you like your jelly? And they say, yes, thank you so much for contacting me by email or by phone, I love my jelly. Okay, so that's day one. Day two, she repeats the exact same experiment, but now she puts out 24 jellies. Now, if you think about it, the same six jellies are there. So if you like the, whiskey raspberry deluxe, it's still there. If that was the best thing and made you happy, it's still an option. But now what she finds is that only 3% of consumers actually wind up buying jelly. And when she calls them at home or emails them, they say, I hated my jelly. I'm so unhappy about my jelly. I should have picked a different jelly. And this is a real puzzle because to an economist, the 24 jelly case is just giving them more information to make a more informed choice. And we know that that doesn't work. Once choice sets get over, say, let's say, people fight about this, somewhere between 3 and 10 is the maximum number we handle. Well, above that number, people just behave at chance, they're miserable, they're filled with regret, consumer behavior is lousy, blah, terrible. Okay, so nobody can figure out how this works. We realized about 3 years ago that some of these features of interactions between the jellies had the flavor of the standard theory of cortex. Now, there is a standard mathematical model of the cortex, this part of the brain we've been talking about, which says that neurons right next to each other inhibit each other in a very complicated way that maximizes the amount of information that they can carry. What essentially neurons do is they check with their neighbor to see if they're saying the same thing. And if their neighbor's saying the same thing, they agree to split that message and only say half of it. The result is you get some weird, unexpected fluctuations. And when lots of neighbors are speaking at the same time, the fact that the message gets split up so broadly basically kills the message and allows the variability to dominate. So we've built models of this, and it turns out that the models really precisely fit the data, and this led us to record in monkeys and do a cursive choice experiment, or at least the first step of a three-step cursive choice experiment, and it seems like it's working. It seems like we can predict the stochastic interactions of the neurons from the standard theory of cortex. We've even been able to predict novel cursive choice paradoxes and show that the monkeys at least show them. We're in the process of showing the humans show them. So my guess is cursive choice will be the first really big triumph for neuroeconomics, where we'll explain a puzzling economic phenomena at the algorithmic mathematical level, and it'll all make sense, but it wouldn't have made sense without neuroscience.
Well, thank you, Dr. Glimcher. That was a great talk and some fabulous questions.
Thank you.